News, President Duterte has granted amnesty to members of several rebel groups, including the Moro National Liberation Front and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, who have committed crimes for their political beliefs in the past. The proclamations, however, state amnesty cannot be granted to persons who have been proscribed as terrorists or charged under the Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020. Joining us now is Attorney Naguib Sinarimbo. He is the Interior Minister of the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, or BARMM. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us again on the program.
Good morning, Christian. Magandang umaga sa mga kababayan natin.
Okay, let's start with the basics. Why President Duterte in the first place had to issue an amnesty proclamation for rebels belonging to the MILF as part of the normalization process, as part of the peace agreement?
Yes, Christian, it's part of the comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro, specifically in the annex on normalization. There's a provision for confidence building measures. One of the confidence building measures enumerated there is the grant of amnesty to members of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front.
Okay, and how many MILF combatants are expected to benefit from this proclamation?
We don't have the exact numbers as yet, but from the initial meetings that we have conducted in the Joint Normalization Committee, there would be roughly around 1,000 members of the MILF. The numbers are still being determined because some of the cases filed do not have specific names from the members of the MILF. So there are jandos and jendes in some of the information filed against their members.
Okay, isn't that a bit small compared to the 40,000 combatants that are expected to decommission?
We will have to get the numbers from different offices of government, from the Office of the Prosecution Services, from different areas, those that have been filed in courts, as well as those still being processed in the law enforcement agencies of government. So we don't have the exact numbers yet.
Now, just for clarification, what exactly does an amnesty proclamation do? Does it extinguish the crime or just the punishment?
In legal parlance, amnesty erases the criminal liability and restores political rights to the individual. So you enjoy all the rights that every citizen normally enjoys.
And why is this important in the first place in the context of the peace agreement that was signed by the Philippine government with the Moro Islamic Liberation Front in 2014?
Two very important things for that. One is that there is a provision that allows MILF, in fact, encourages MILF to transition into civilian life. So this one would at least allow them to be reintegrated into society again. The other one is that if they are to participate in political exercises, such as the right to vote, or be voted for in the event they want to participate in the political process, cases would affect their chances of running for public office. So okay, it's important that we have the amnesty.
Now, does the amnesty proclamation, of course, that was issued by the president, which would also require congressional concurrence. But in this case, how high up in the hierarchy are we talking about here in terms of those who are expected to benefit from the proclamation?
There are members of the Central Committee, the highest organ of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. There are also very senior commanders on the field, such as front commanders, base commanders, and senior commanders of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front.
Is there any among those who are serving now in the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, in the BTA, the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, that are expected to be included in the list that would benefit from the proclamation?
Yes, definitely, Christian.
Okay. Now, ito, I'm asking the basic questions because people might be asking this. For instance, how come they were allowed to serve in the BTA if there were pending cases still against them?
Some of these cases have not been filed in court. So in reality, there are no pending cases against them as yet. Some are filed against individuals. Nom de guerre ang nagamit. So there is no certainty na sila yon. So these are some of the challenges and the issues that we need to resolve also.
Now, how long do you think the process would take before this entire amnesty proclamation is completed in order for the MILF combatants to be able to resume their transition to civilian life?
We're hoping it would be quick. For one, Congress needs to express its concurrence on the proclamation. Second, the Amnesty Commission would have to be constituted, and then the MILF combatants would have to file their application for amnesty. So it would take some time to do that, but we're hoping this one would be quick.
Isn't this late, the amnesty proclamation? Because I remember this was supposed to come sooner, right?
Yes, it's part of the CBM, and in peace agreements, the confidence building measure normally comes earlier so that you build the confidence of the rebel organization to continue to engage with government. But this one came really a bit late. In fact, the first draft that we submitted to government was late 2014 when we were negotiating in Kuala Lumpur. Just immediately after we signed the annex on normalization, we already presented a draft proclamation to our counterparts in the government negotiating panel.
Why do you think it took time before President Duterte issued an amnesty proclamation?
We're not really sure. In fact, the first draft proclamation was submitted to the former president, President Aquino. And then when the new president was elected, a new panel was reconstituted. We also submitted a draft proclamation for this.
So why do you think it was delayed?
We're not sure, really. One is that there was difficulty, I think, in determining the exact number of those who will benefit. There was also a debate in government whether it will cover all crimes in pursuance of the political belief of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front.
But and on the part of the MILF and also the BTA, how do you make sure that only those who committed crimes before related to their political beliefs or advocacies will be covered by the amnesty proclamation, and that those who might have been engaged in terroristic acts won't be benefiting from this?
We're also careful about that because, you know, of the split earlier in the ranks of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, and there were those who earlier advocated that we don't need the negotiations and therefore separated from the mainstream Moro Islamic Liberation Front. Some of them have actually engaged in acts that are not within the rules of engagement issued by the leadership of the Bangsamoro Islamic Armed Forces. So we also don't want them to be covered by that. But at the same time, there are also members of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front who've been charged with terrorism. And so we'll have to settle that also with government.
Okay. And do you think this would actually expedite the normalization process, in particular the decommissioning process? Because some are saying that the process has been quite slow. And you cannot exactly blame just the MILF, but also the national government. And also because we're in the middle of a pandemic. But still, there are questions being raised regarding how successful this entire decommissioning process as part of the normalization process would be.
That's true, Christian. There has been a concern expressed by the Moro Islamic Liberation Front that some aspects of the agreement has been moving very, very slowly. Part of that is the issue of amnesty pardon. And we're happy that this time, amnesty has been proclaimed by the president.
Okay, but for example, what's the calendar now? I understand the first batch of combatants numbered 12,000, right? But we're still talking here of 28,000 MILF members.
Yes, the next batch would be around 14,000. That's 35% of the combatants of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. We have the list already from the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. We're just waiting for some other processes to proceed before the list would actually be submitted to the independent decommissioning body.
If the BTA is not extended and the elections proceed next year for the BARMM, do you think this could compromise the pace of the decommissioning process?
From a review of the process that has been undertaken earlier for decommissioning the combatants, it would no longer be feasible to complete the decommissioning process in the remaining 1 year of the transition period. That's already impossible to do. So we should seriously reconsider the issue of extending the period of transition in the Bangsamoro, because a lot of the aspects of the peace agreement has not been implemented as yet.
Is the parliament still working on an electoral code?
Yes. In fact, tomorrow, the cabinet committee that's in charge of drafting the electoral code would already be finalizing the draft. Once it is finalized at the cabinet committee, it will be submitted to the cabinet, and then the cabinet will transmit that to the parliament for enactment. This is the parliamentary system.
Yeah, but do you actually
quite different.
But do you actually intend to finish the electoral code, given the fact that you are pushing to hold off the elections next year?
Yes, we are committed to passing the electoral code before mid-year of 2021 this year, regardless of whether the period of transition extended or not. The Bangsamoro Parliament and the leadership of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front is committed to passing the electoral code.
So that should address concerns that the Bangsamoro Parliament might not be working in earnest to pass an electoral code, because in the first place, you guys want to extend the BTA in the first place. But even if that happens, no, let's say walang electoral code, tuloy yung election, of course, I think there's a provision. I mean, the COMELEC, the national, the one in Manila, central government, the national government, the Commission on Elections has that option, right, to still facilitate the elections even without the electoral code in the Bangsamoro. Is that correct?
In reality, it cannot proceed. The election would not be held without the electoral code passed by the parliament, because there are no rules governing the election of the members of parliament in all existing legislations of the country, or even in the legislation of the previous ARMM. It would also be difficult to proceed with an elections where the rules for parliamentary districts, party representation, qualification for candidates are not existing. So it's really impossible. But as earlier said, the Bangsamoro Parliament is determined to pass that, whether we are extended or there would be elections in 2022.
So are you still also working as if there would be elections next year?
Yes. For the parliament, the timeline is still 2022 to enact the priority legislation. In fact, by next week, the civil service code would already be passed by the parliament. Yesterday was the last deliberation in the plenary for the civil service code. Okay. By next week, they will already vote for the code.
And finally, are you also working to help educate the people in the Bangsamoro regarding this parliamentary elections that are scheduled next year? Because this is quite different, and we know that as we speak, a lot of people are still quite confused.
Yes, it's a complex election, actually. If we add the layer of the parliamentary elections, and there would be three sets of members of parliament that will be elected in the Bangsamoro. One would be parliamentary district representation. Second would be the party representation. Third would be sectoral and reserve seats. So which is quite complex. So if we add that to the layer of the national elections, the regular elections in the local government units, and you have a complex parliamentary system of elections, gets a bit complex.
Yeah, because you have a system of proportional representation that represents a portion of the parliament, and of course the reserved seats. But I hope people will get more informed or educated about this system. Thank you very much, Attorney Sinarimbo, for joining us this morning, sir.
Pleasure. Good morning, and thank you very much.